thanks to Jamie and all those that went forth to do that. It was just such a blessing yesterday, and then he washed it out there at the very end. And so, but it was a good thing, and I know that that Justin's family will be blessed by that. So what a praise to be able to have that go in. Thanks for everybody's effort that went there yesterday. It looked like a bunch of wet rats there at the end. Everybody got soaked, but that's good. Everybody just did it together. So what a praise. And then I do want to announce something special this morning. We have two people that are in the congregation that have changed. In other words, we've seen them together for a long time, and we've seen them together as Sandy Tippins and Mike Keeney, but now they're Mr. and Mrs. Mike Keeney. Would you please stand up? Amen. 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 So that's wonderful. Make sure that you tell them congratulations. And then as far as bulletin announcements go, a lot of announcements in the bulletin. I'm going to try to be as brief as I can. But first of all, just remember that choir practice for the kids. There will be no choir practice this afternoon. We're having a different kind of service today. Today we do want to invite you right after the service. We're going to be eating together. We have a luncheon after the service out in the fellowship hall, and we want everybody to come, and it's going to be a big day. We're going to eat together, and then we're going to come back in here after everyone eats. We're going to come back in here, and we're going to have a singing today. And how many people are going to come to the singing today? Raise your hand. Glory to God. It's going to be a good time, and Vicky's got something good prepared for us, so we're excited about that. Always a good time just to be able to come and fellowship in song and just praise the Lord. So that's going to be today. And then because of that, we're not going to have an evening service. Our service is going to be the song service, so we will not have an evening service this evening. Remember this announcement, October the 19th, next Sunday evening, we're going to be able to have a baptism, the Lord willing, at the YMCA. And this is always a huge event. If you are someone who realizes that you need to be baptized, if you've been saved and not baptized, maybe you've just been convicted, maybe you didn't understand it when it happened in your life, maybe you were young and you went through the motions but didn't understand it, please see me because I want to be able to talk to you. We have quite a few that are signed up for this baptism service now. They came to the class this past Thursday, but anyone else that wants to be baptized, it's not too late. I just need to meet with you. That way we go over and talk about baptism. I'm just a firm believer that when you're baptized, you need to understand exactly what it means. It is not a step of, it is not your salvation that gets you to heaven. It's a step of obedience after your salvation. Amen? Amen. So, the blessings God has put on us in these almost 7 years here has been phenomenal. One of the ways is seeing so many people baptized, and that baptism is a commitment where you're burying the old self. And if you have been baptized, just to bear witness, if you've been baptized in this church since the church opened, would you please stand at this time? Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. What a blessing. I think last time we've been privileged to see over 200 people baptized, which is such a blessing in these years we've been here. So we look forward to that. Just please see me so I can make sure your name's on the list and we have a time to meet. And then don't forget, the youth have the trick-or-treat so others can eat coming up. This is the event that they've been doing. You'll see the bags that are in the back, and those bags are just the paper bags that you fill up with canned goods and non-perishables. Bring them back in to the church by October the 26th, and they'll go to Rowan Helping Ministries. We'll be going to the neighborhoods and giving out those bags, but of course you at church here, just pick up your bag and bring it back. So we want to be able to bring as much food to them as we can. And then don't forget the Samaritan Shoebox Ministry. Celeste is heading that up, so please see Celeste. Her contact information is in the bulletin. And then look at the other announcements between youth news and the upcoming meetings, and you'll be able to see all that's going on. As far as prayer requests go, continue to remember Brother Bob Lohman and Jeff Earnhardt, Nancy Lynn and Chloe Monroe. Each one of those, as we say their name each week, lifting them up as they're battling cancer, leukemia. And then remember Brother Billy Hutchinson and Marilyn Olvey as they're gaining strength. And then we have some that are recovering from surgery and doing well. That's Denise Peel. Lift up Denise. Got to spend some time with her this week, and she's doing better and better. And then Amanda Collins. Amanda's improving daily. She had her staples and things taken out this week, so I know she's feeling better, and it just looks like she's feeling better. So please keep praying for her. Then we have some that are having upcoming surgery. Brother Grady Morris is having surgery on Tuesday. They're going to remove some more lymph nodes, so be lifting up Grady. And at the same time, at another hospital in Charlotte, Lisa Baker is going to be having some surgery. So lift up Lisa. She's going to be going through some surgery also, and we need to be lifting both of those up in prayer. And then also in the hospital or in rehab is Paul Benfield's dad, Van Benfield. So be praying for Van. Lift him up as he's in rehab trying to just regain the ability to be able to get around. And then Harry Evans. This is Laura and Tony Evans' dad. Harry's been coming on Sunday and Wednesdays. He had to go to Northeast on Friday evening with some heart issues, and saw him yesterday, and he'll be having a heart cath tomorrow. So pray for Harry. Lift up Harry if you would. And then I'm sure that you have prayer requests. I'm sure there's so many that are on your heart. If you have a prayer request that you want to make known to the Lord, just do it by raising your hand if you would, please. And the Lord sees those hands, so we'll pray together. Father, we love you so much and just thank you for this opportunity that you've given us to come and worship. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace. We thank you, Lord, for the sweet Holy Spirit that you give us. And we thank you for salvation, the gift of salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, God, that you've given us a place to worship. You've given us the ability to come in here and worship. And, Lord, we just thank you for the freedom you've given us to worship. We pray, God, today for each of those that can't be here and those that are sick and suffering, those that are facing surgery or recovering from surgery, Lord, or sick in body. We just pray for your healing according to your will, and just praying, God, that you would heal, believing, Lord, and accepting whatever your perfect will is. We pray for those that are discouraged, those that are grieving and mourning. We just pray, God, and lift them up to you, asking you just to comfort them in their time of need. And then, Lord, we pray for this service today. I just pray, Lord, today that you would just minister to us. Lord, as we gather in here today, we come in here with different things on our mind, and we come distracted, Lord. We come with schedules and agendas, and we come, Lord, with the problems of life. And I just pray, Lord, that you would remove those problems, remove those anxieties and fears from our minds so that we can focus on you and you alone, and teach us today, Lord. I pray as your word is read, Lord, that if there's someone here that's never accepted Jesus as their Savior, I pray that today is the day that they see their need. And I pray today, Lord, if there's anyone here that has accepted you but has drifted away, or their relationship is not as strong as it needs to be, other things have come in the way, I pray, God, that you would find them where they are, as you did me. And Lord, just speak to them and draw them back close to you. Let your word come alive to all of us today, Lord. For each person that's in here that's walking with you, Lord, strengthen the relationship that they have with you today through your word. I pray that you paint a picture for us today, Lord, that we can take from here and hide in our hearts. Father, as we lift up our voice in praise to you in song, I pray that you would just receive our offering of praise, and that you would bless us with your presence. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. What a good-looking crowd this morning. Good-looking crowd. Are you happy to be here? If you are, say amen.
Amen.
You realize that when Jesus Christ comes into you and you accept Jesus as your Savior, you realize that you're a winner, right? How many people know you're a winner? When you're a winner, then you should be able to sing like a winner. So this morning, we're going to sing Victory in Jesus. You say we sing Victory in Jesus a lot. That's right, because that's what we're sure of. We're sure of a victory. And when you have victory, you sing about it a lot. And in case you're wondering, you're going to continue to sing this song after you leave this world. The Bible tells us in the book of Revelation that we're going to stand and sing, "Worthy, worthy is the Lamb." That's who we have victory from. So we need to get ready here. And if you can't sing about Him here, it's going to be hard to sing about Him there. How many people want to sing about Him?
Amen.
Do you have that victory?
Amen.
Then let's stand and sing. Greg's going to come. The choir's going to come. We're going to sing Victory in Jesus.
Thank you. seats. We'll continue with worship.
Back talking to those preparing the meals today, and they were wanting to get a count, but I don't know if you've ever done this before, but you forgot that today was Pastor Appreciation, so you didn't bring a side dish, and usually I feel uncomfortable not going over there, but I just want to tell you, if you're visiting or whether you forgot to bring something or hadn't been here in a few weeks, please join us for fellowship. It'll be a good opportunity to meet this great family. So, all right, please bow your heads in prayer. Father God, thank you for your faithfulness, your blessings, and just your love. And thank you for this church family and our pastors. As we prepare, come in to prepare our hearts to hear your word, please help us put aside those external influences and distractions of the world. And please help us to prepare our hearts and minds to receive your word. And Father God, please be with Mike and bless him. And please give him the strength of words and the inspiration to deliver your message, and that it may nourish our spirits, our hearts, and minds. And Father God, thanks again for this family. And I really do appreciate being here. And thanks for all the visitors and all those that serve in some type of capacity here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within could I see. But then they searched through hell. Heaven. Savior to save a poor lost soul like me. With calmness sweet and serene, he came down from heaven and he gave his life's blood to make the chilling water I'll soon be crossing, but his hand, it will lead me safe. Oh, you know what I'm talking about. I'll join that chorus city, and we'll sing up there forevermore. Join with the choir as we sing this chorus.
Kind of most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just again, Lord, we thank you for, oh, what a Savior. Lord, as we prepare our hearts for the service, Lord, let it be open, let it be receptive to the word, Lord, and let us never forget the cost it was paid at Calvary for our sins. And Lord, we just ask you to be this offering we're about to take, Lord, use it for the upbuilding of your kingdom, Lord, and we give you all the honor and glory in Jesus' name.
Thank you. what a blessing it is just to stand up here. It's a humbling experience, but to just to show appreciation to our pastors, we've got a little thing we want to show here right quick. I'm going to ask Dale to start that. And after we see this video and listen to the music, I'm going to ask Joe Earnhardt to come up, and we're going to do a little presentation here. I encourage you to listen to the words of this song. We've all been touched by our pastors here, and I just want to say thank you to the pastors right now. But I encourage you to listen to the words of the song. And if Greg, if you'll cut some lights off.
Dreamed I went to heaven, and you were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing, and someone called your name. We turned and saw this young man, and he was smiling as he came. And he said, "Friend, you may not know me now." And then he said, "But wait, you used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave." Then another man stood before you and said, "Remember the time a missionary came to your church? His pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm here today. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. One by one they came, far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, I noticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, "My child, look around you, for great is your reward." Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed.
We blessed. I appreciate that spirit being here this morning too. But I'm going to turn it over to Joe, and he's got a little presentation here to give to our pastors.
Yeah. Wow, what a video. We are so blessed to have Mike as our pastor. Just such an awesome leader. His dedication to serving the Lord and serving this church body is just wonderful. I mean, we could not ask for a better person to serve this church. We're also blessed to have Blake as our assistant. Vicky, Sabrina, they do so much each week for our church, our church body. And on behalf of church body, we just have a small appreciation gift for each of them. If Mike and Blake, Sabrina and Vicky would please come forward.
Like I say, we are so blessed. At this time, I'd like the families of the pastors just to stand up, just to recognize them as well. And it's Vicky and Sabrina. I know it's past appreciation, but without the help of Sabrina and with Vicky doing the music, and even everybody else that's involved with the music and everything, but I'd like to ask their families to stand up so we could recognize them at this time too. Let us always just be burdened to pray for our pastors. They go through more sometimes in a week than we go through in a whole month or even a year. Let's always just keep them in our prayers and just thank God for this church and the lives it's changed. Thank you.
You may be seated. They changed the service up on me today. I knew when they sang three of my favorite songs, something was going on. But when we sang Victory in Jesus, Little as Much When God Is In It, and Oh What a Savior, the first line of that song, it got me at when I was wondering. And all of us have wondered, haven't we? And I just praise God for that. I know it's Pastor Appreciation Day. It's a little awkward to be receiving that praise. I would just simply say thank you. I'm the one that feels blessed to be here. And Salem does too. But I want to tell before Holly leaves the room, I do want to tell her and Blake what a blessing it is and how much we appreciate them. For God to send us somebody like him and his wife Holly, we are surely blessed. And I know that you feel the same way. Somebody that God orchestrated to come here. So we really have seen the hand of God work. And we love you. You're a blessing to us. And we appreciate everything that you do. And just loving the church. And I know the parents loving their kids. That's a big deal to have somebody that really cares. So for that, we say thank you. But then as somebody that works with you, glory to God. I praise God for your spirit. I praise God for your love for him. And I just am so pleased that I get to be a part of this with you. So I'm thankful for that. Thanks to Sabrina also, who is my right hand during the week, and for Miss Vicky also, who God has sent us. And if you heard Victory in Jesus sang like that, knowing that the Spirit here is just moving in here in the music, I just praise God for her. And so what a blessing that is. And then I want to give all glory to God, because it's God that does this. This is why it's a little awkward with me, really. I'm just ready to preach today. And just trying to get through the appreciation, and I appreciate being appreciated. But really, the thanks that I would say as far as on this day should rather go to my family than me, because they really give more than I do. I just do what I'm supposed to do and try to, and when it comes in front of me, I just react and do it. And they're the ones that have to be able to accept it, which is a different part of the ministry I don't know that I understood beforehand. But I know that when I married my wife, I promised her that I would put her first. And just about every day, I have to put her second and put somebody else first. And she's been good with that. And I try to put her back first as soon as I'm done. But for somebody to be okay with that, she deserves more than. Yeah, my family too, where plans can be changed on a dime. Thank you. Appreciate your understanding that it's not that I don't love you. It's just that I love the Lord more than I love you. And that's got to be good with you. So, the only thing that I can say, and I think Forrest Gump said it best. Yeah, we're going to quote Forrest Gump. You ever see Forrest Gump? It's hard for me to receive praise and acclaim for something like Forrest said to Jenny whenever he received the Congressional Medal of Honor, and he gave it to her. He said, "I got it just doing what you told me to do." And that's all I do, is I just have a good seat to watch it happen here, and I try to do what he tells me to do, so all honor and glory goes to him. He makes it look like we really know what we're doing, but we don't. It's just a day-to-day thing where we just do what he tells us to do, and I guess in fitting, the book of Revelation brings that into fruition, because it says that any crowns we received, we'll cast them right back down at his feet. So we'll give all of our things away, and I want to give this praise back away quickly today to him and say glory to God for all this. I just happen to be in this position, so thank you. And now, these babies, these children, I want the children to come up. Good morning. How's everybody doing? Listen, I want you to tell me, what does this look like to you?
A Bible.
Yeah, it's not a Bible. This is a very, very special book. You see, it's not a Bible, because look on the pages. Do you see it? Does that look like a Bible to you?
Notebook. It looks like a notebook.
It's not a notebook. This is my special book. This is my friend book. This is the book that I write down the people's names that love me. So if I read this book, I would be able to see the people's names that love me. I just read this book. Now, this is my book. So let's just get over that. This is Mike's book of people that love him. Who wants to be in this book? Is anybody? You're kidding me. Jacob Seifert, do you want to be in this book? I'm going to write your name in there, okay? All right, Jacob Seifert. Okay, who else wants to be? Layla, you want to be in this book? I'm going to write your name in here. Layla Ewing. Who else wants to be in this book? Sammy, do you want to be in this book? All right, Sammy. I'm going to write your name down in here. Okay, Lily, did I see your hand raised? You want to be in this book, do you? All right. Lily Klutz is in this book. Who else wants to be in this book? Raise your hand if you want to be. Jack Morris, do you want to be in this book? All right. Easton, you want to be in here? Okay. Well, do you love me? Do you love me? Okay, I can write your name in here. Now, all right. Now, I'm going to write down the rest of the names later, okay? But now, is anybody in here trust me? If you trust me, I'll write your name in this book too. Who trust you? Do you trust me? What's your name? Boogie. I'll write your name in here, Boogie. Okay. Anybody else in here? Trust me. Eva, you trust me? I'm going to write your name in here. All right.
Looks like Jasmine wants too.
Jasmine, you want your name in here? You trust me? Ada, you want your name in here? Okay, here we go. Now, look what I have in here. I have everybody's names that said that they trusted me written right here in this book. Lawson, you want your name in there? Okay, Lawson, you put your name in here. So if you read this book, I would read names like Jacob Seifert, Layla Ewing, Sammy, Lily Klutz, Jack Morris, and then that trust me, Boogie and Eva and Jasmine and Ada and Lawson. So this is my book. And the people's names that love me are written in my book. Who wrote them? I wrote them. I had to know that you trust me, okay? Now, there could be somebody out here that doesn't trust me. So I want to use Pastor Blake as an example, okay? Now, understand, you're going to need to come up here. Now, listen, we're just pretending, so don't leave here saying things, okay? This is just an act, because I know Pastor Blake loves me, and I know he trusts me, but I want him to pretend that he doesn't love me and he doesn't trust me. Can you pretend and do that?
Absolutely.
Okay, so I'm going to ask the question again. Listen to this. Pastor Blake, do you love me?
No.
You don't love me?
No, sir.
Well, then I can't write your name in this book.
Okay.
Do you trust me? You don't trust me.
No.
So you don't love me or trust me?
No.
You probably don't even care that your name's not written in this book, right?
I don't care.
Okay, well, then I can't write your name in the book. So I want you to understand, if you don't love me or trust me, I can't put it in there. Now, how important is it to be in Pastor Mike's book? Well, it's not as important. It's not as important as you think it is, okay? This just records who loves me and trusts me. But do you know what? Jesus has a book. Jesus has a book. My book's called Mike's book. You know what his book is called? It's called the Lamb's Book of Life. And do you know that whenever you get old enough to realize that, hey, I love Jesus and I want to trust him and ask him to be my Savior and ask him to forgive me, and you give yourself to him and say, I want you to be my friend and I want you to come into my heart, guess what? He writes your name in his book, and that book is called the Lamb's Book of Life. Say that with me. The Lamb's Book of Life. Now, it might not be as important to be in Pastor Mike's book, but I'll tell you one thing, it's very important to be in the Lamb's Book of Life. And if you want to be in the Lamb's Book of Life, you've got to love him and you've got to trust him. So how many people want to be in the Lamb's Book of Life?
Me.
Amen. So as you get older, make sure that you know, because listen, you never know the chances that he's going to give you. In other words, even though Pastor Blake said he didn't love me and said he didn't trust me, and his name, if I get looking at my book and if I was Jesus, I would see his name's not here. He's not going to get to go to heaven with me, right? But I'll tell you what, I'll give him another chance. If he tells me he's sorry, and he tells me that he loves me and he trusts me, well, let's just see. I'm going to give you another chance. Do you love me?
Yes, sir.
He does love me. Do you trust me?
I do.
Now, let me look at your heart. Let me see that you mean it. Because that's what Jesus does. And if you do, then guess what? After all those chances, he'll go back and write your name in his book. He gave me a lot of chances, but you don't know how many you'll get. Listen, it's not important to be in Pastor Mike's book, but it's very important to be in the Lamb's book of life. That's Jesus' book. How many people want to be in it? Amen. All right, let's pray, okay? Father, I love you, I praise you, and I thank you. I thank you, Lord, for the hearts of each child that's here. I pray, God, that you would minister to them. And Lord, I just pray, God, that you would speak to them through the people in this church, Lord, through their parents, through their family. Lord, guide and direct them to you. Give them, Lord, the opportunities to hear you. Lord, I pray that you prepare their hearts so that as they reach that age, they can accept the gift of Jesus as their Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. How many people want fruity snacks? All right. You can't crowd. You can't be mean. You got to stand up and take it one at a time. Don't push anybody. Don't push anybody. Don't push anybody.
I got this guy.
Okay. Here you go. Don't push anybody. Let me put this pin up so nobody gets stabbed, okay? There you go. I love you. Love you. Here you go. There you go, honey. Here you go. There you go. There you go. Here you go. Amen. There you go, Boogie.
We call him Boogie. His real name is Shakir Roberts.
I'm probably better to say Boogie. Yeah. Shakir, that's his name? Okay. There you go. Here you go. Hey, Brandon. Good to see you, buddy. Hey. How you doing, Ada? You're welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. There, Mallory. There you go. Thank you. How many people have your Bible today? Raise it in the air, stand up underneath it, bear witness of God's word. Amen. Wave it around just a bit. We need that force field, don't we? You may be seated. What a privilege it is to share God's word with you today. Turn, if you would, please, to the book of Revelation, chapter 20. Revelation, chapter 20. The next place that you'll mark will be 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So Revelation chapter 20, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We began to speak last week about the different books that we read about in the Bible. And we began to read Revelation chapter 20, and we were able to see that God gave us a glimpse of the future. He let us be able to see a time when we would stand in front of Him. And we would be able to be judged. That means everything that you've done is going to be remembered. And we were able to see in Revelation chapter 20 something called the white throne judgment. That's where those who have never accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior will be judged. And we were able to see in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that everyone who has accepted Christ as their Savior, that's where you'll be judged. It's called the judgment seat of Christ. So you have the white throne judgment for those that are lost. You have the judgment seat of Christ for those that are saved. In each account, we were able to see that the things that we have done in our lifetime have been recorded. Scary thought, isn't it? And I'm not just talking about the things that you would record. Understand, we learned last week, we're not the ones that do the writing in this book. If I were writing my own book, I would omit a lot. And you would omit a lot. It's evident to me that the things that God tells us to do, sometimes we fail to do them, and we actually think we have a reason not to do them, as if we could rewrite the Bible. So some of my inserts, if I were writing my book, would say, I didn't do this, but here's why. I didn't worship today, but here's why. I didn't read the Bible, but here's why. I didn't pray like I should have, here's why. I wasn't compassionate, but here's why. I wasn't faithful, here's why. I said those things, here's why. I was hateful, here's why. And we actually think we come up with reasons for these. I hear people's reasons, believe me. I hear the reasons that they don't worship. Go ahead and remember, you're not writing your book. God knows exactly why you didn't. He knows exactly what you've put in front of Him. He knows exactly why we didn't pray like we should, why we didn't read like we should, why we didn't worship like we should. He knows exactly the selfish things that we do. So He writes the book. There's no "and here's why." We become good at justifying things, don't we? As a matter of fact, I could have an entirely different book that's called Mike's Justification Book. Couldn't you? Which sounded good to me at the time, but I realized that if God can read my mind and really knows me, they won't make His book. In the book of Revelation, we read these words and listen to the references to the books. Revelation chapter 20 says, "And the devil that deceived them," verse 10, "was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and Him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened." What was open? Plural. Pay attention that that is plural, please. The books were opened. And another book was open. So the books were open and another book was open. Now, we think sometimes, okay, God has recorded our name. And what we know about the Lamb's Book of Life is that that's the book. But understand, in reading this and understanding it, we need to know that there are other books besides the Lamb's Book of Life. And we learned last week about one book in particular. Do you remember the name of that book? The Book of You, or the Book of Me. That's our own story. Understanding, we learned in the Bible that God keeps an account of each person. Everything that we've done, right or wrong, He keeps an account of it. That's what we'll be judged according to. That's the books. The Book of Me, the Book of You, the Book of You, the Book of You. Those books are going to be open because God keeps an account. That is the testimony against us, the things that we've done wrong. And it's the testimony for us that your rewards are based on. Everybody has their own book. It's called the Book of whatever your name is. I want you to turn to the person beside of you, and I want you to be able to tell them, God is writing the book of, and then I want you to say your name. Now understand this, that today, there will be inserts into this book. If you are lost or if you are saved, and understand, we have two groups of people here. We do not have men and women. We do not have tall and short. We do not have black and white. We do not have old and young. We have saved and lost. Inevitably, that is the two categories that God keeps up with, saved and lost. The lost will stand at the white throne judgment. The books will be open. That means everyone's individual book. Those people have never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, so everything that they have done in refusing Christ is written in their book. And then another book was open. Listen. And another book was open, which was the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their work. So the dead, the lost, were judged according to the things that were written in the books, plural. Now when we go to the end, we'll see that, and whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So we're judged by the books, plural. And if your name is not in the book of life, well, this book of life they're speaking about is the Lamb's book of life. We learned about three books last week, and we talked about one. These three books are the book of you, of course, that's each and every one of us. The book of the living, that's an account, a genealogical account of each person. And the Lamb's book of life. So we've talked about this book of you. We're going to finish about this book of you and go on to the other books. Understand something about this book of you and book of me. If it just stopped at the point of me saying everything that you've done, good or bad, is written in this book, then everyone in here should be groaning right now. Because you know you and I know me. Don't even think about me. Think about you. You've got some things too. If I know that God has written everything in here, then I should be feeling pretty bad right now. The excuses that I gave that maybe you didn't know the real reason, God knows the real reason. And He'll judge according to that. But here's the amazing thing. We learned last week at the end that, well, let me just read you this. This is a promise of God. 1 John 1:9. It says that if we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we learned something last week called blotting out that's put in the Bible. And do you know that God blots out? Now, blotting out means the process of removing something from the pages. Blotting out. Understand that when Peter referenced in Acts 3:19, he was preaching a message to those that were lost, and he said, "Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out." Isn't that great? So what happens? This book of you or this book of me, all the way up until the time that I realize that Jesus is the one that I need to accept, all the way up until that time, these things are written in the book of me, and they're written in the book of you. Once I accept the Lord Jesus Christ and repent and believe on Him, guess what? Believe on Him so that my sins may be blotted out. He takes the mic before Him and blots out everything. Glory to God. We symbolize that by going down into the water at baptism and dying to that old person, right? And glory to God, He has more scripture that tells us that not only does He blot it out, He remembers it no more. That's big. Because I can't even do that. I still remember it, right? That's the act of forgiveness. How do you get it blotted out? How do you get things blotted out of this book of me or book of you? Well, if you're not saved, understand that the only thing that you can do, the only prayer, because see, sin separates us from God. You can't just go to God and talk to Him because you're born. We're all sinners. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God, right? There's none righteous, no, not one. So we can't just go to God and say, hey, since we were born, we're a child of yours. We're not. That child that doesn't know right from wrong, that child that hasn't refused Him, that child can pray. But the moment you realize you could accept Jesus, but you don't, the moment you hear the gospel, the moment that you realize God is here and there's something bigger than yourself and you refuse Him, that's a sin. Those sin come between you and God. God can have nothing to do with sin, so you can't just pray. We see in the movies where somebody walks out and says, oh God, I want to talk to you. Listen, before you say, oh God, you need to say, forgive me, God. We need to clear our heart because we can't come to God with a sinful heart, and all of us are sinful. I'm not saying you're a sinner. I'm saying we're sinners. So as you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, then your heart is clean. Your book, that book of you, He erased everything. And He said, start here. So what if you're saved? If you're saved, was this sermon even important? What about those books? Well, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, this is what we read. It says, verse 10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to what he hath done, whether it is good or bad. That's me and you if we're saved. You realize you have to stand in front of God and give an account? Well, how is this account? Will it be your account? No. That account has been kept in the book of you. That's what you'll be judged against. He knows every time he's given you opportunity to do something and you haven't taken. He knows how we are as husbands. He knows how we are as wives. He knows how we are as parents. He knows how we are as children. He knows how we are as his children, saved people. He knows the times that we've taken advantage of time that he's given us to pray, to worship, to read our Bible. And he knows the times when we've manufactured an excuse that put something in front of him. He knows those times. They're recorded. The hard thing is if we can justify them good enough, you won't ask him to forgive you of them. You'll believe your own excuse. Here's a little hint. If your excuse always includes you being sick on Sunday, but you're making it to work on Monday, you're lying. If your excuse always includes you had something else to do that was more pressing, then you're admitting there's a lot of things before God. Understand, God gets that. You don't have to convince me or somebody else. He gets it. And if you never reach the point of realizing that you're wrong, you won't ask him for forgiveness. You won't get forgiveness. You have to ask for forgiveness to get forgiveness. So understand, we're judged according to what we do, and it's written in our books. And then he blots out. So Christian, you use the blood of Jesus on a daily basis. You don't just use it to get saved. I used it this morning. Every time you have a thought, understand, he reads your thoughts. You don't just get saved and use his blood. You have to use his blood to blot out your daily things, because I could be saved but still not be able to come to God and pray to him today if there's unconfessed sin in my life. So if I want to be able to talk to God, I've got to be able to confess it. You say, well, maybe you're not as bad as me, but I don't remember everything I've done. Me either. But I ask God to convict me. Understand, here's what happens. As a Christian, I've been here before. I've wandered before. And when you refuse to acknowledge what you're doing and you accept your own excuses, well, you're convicted the first time. And then you're convicted the second time. And then you begin to believe it and you sort of judge anybody that might hold you accountable. And then the fourth time it's easier, the fifth time it's easier. Before long, somebody that used to be here every Sunday, you might see them occasionally, then you don't see them at all. Somebody that used to be instant in reading their Bible, they missed a day. The second day is easier. The third day is even easier. What happens? How does that work that way? What happens is our fellowship with God is damaged. Because unless we go and use that blood every day to ask him for forgiveness, well, here's what happens. Let's say I miss today, and then I miss tomorrow. Well, I can't fellowship with God until I get forgiveness, right? Because God can have nothing to do with sin. If I'm a sinner, I need to ask him to use that blood of Jesus to blot out this so that I can have fellowship with him. If I don't do it today and don't do it tomorrow, well, by the time I get to Monday or Tuesday, listen, my fellowship's further and further away. I can tell you for a fact, as being somebody that's close to God and away from God, once you're away, you're not even convicted like you used to be. You go deeper fast. The things when I was walking with the Lord that I knew not to do and I wasn't okay with. I didn't need somebody else to tell me. The Spirit was convicting me. Once I chose not to do them for a while and that sin added up and added up, well, it became easy. Why? Because there was no voice. Even though the Spirit was in me, I had no communication with God because of sin. So even the conviction of the Holy Spirit, the voice was lighter and lighter and lighter. Surely that's not just me. Can I get a witness that ever happened to anybody else? And it takes something tragic. It takes something to where all of a sudden all those things that you've put in front of him are not as big as the thing that's in front of you right now. To where it's the chastisement of God and he breaks you. Because that's the only way he can get your attention. He loves you. So he wants to get your attention, and when that happens, you fall to your knees because the only place you have to look is up. And when you look up, then you ask for forgiveness. And then at that point, he uses the blood to blot out. I'm going to make a statement to you, and immediately you're going to want to theologically challenge this, so I'm expecting it. There is something besides the blood of Jesus that you need to get forgiveness. Immediately, if you're a Christian, you're thinking, you're off track. All you need is the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. There's two things that are required to get your sins forgiven. The blood of Jesus and your belief in the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus was shed for everyone, but not everyone will accept it. Whosoever will, let him come. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord. Whosoever. It was shed for everybody, but not everybody accepts it. So two things, the blood and our belief in his blood. So I want to show you something. There was an old way, and now there's a new way. The old way was before Jesus, and the new way is after Jesus. The old way, God required a sacrifice, a blood sacrifice. If you go back to the book of Genesis, which I'm not going to ask you to go back there, even when Adam and Eve sinned, the first sacrifice to cover them, to clothe their nakedness, an animal had to be killed, right? That was the first blood sacrifice. From then on, God instituted, we even found out with Cain and Abel, that in order to please God, you needed to make a blood sacrifice, right? From then on, the lamb was taken and sacrificed on the altar, and that was the way man had his sins covered. Say that word with me, covered. But when we get to Hebrews 8, see, because they had to keep going back and keep going back. When we get to Hebrews 8 and Hebrews 10, we find out something pretty neat. In Hebrews 8, we're reminded, we're told that Jesus came and that there was a new and better way to have fellowship with God. The old way was through the Old Testament law, which required a priest to make an atonement for each person by presenting an animal blood sacrifice. But the sacrifice was used to cover sins. Listen, listen to this. This is big. It just covered it. You say, is that not good enough? Jesus' blood blots out. The Old Testament blood just covered. Listen, even when I was writing my sermon notes, I've got this little thing that you can just wipe across here and it whites out. Love it, right? But do you know that if I scratch that off, the writing's still under there? It's not erased, it's covered. His blood blots out. Glory to God. Never to be remembered again. Glory to God. Thank God for that. We're told in verse 12 of Hebrews 8, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins and iniquities. Listen to this. Will I remember no more? Do you know that God has the ability not to remember your sin against you? That's big, isn't it? I counsel so many people that say, well, I know how that guy used to be. And believe me, when I run into people, I ran into a guy the other week that I went to high school with that I haven't seen in 30-some years, right? And he said, I heard you were a preacher. With his eyes like, a preacher? Like, did I hear right? Because the last time I saw you was 30 years ago. And I said, yes, you heard right. I'm an experienced sinner, and I preach about it. I've been forgiven, but what happened? He said, I will remember it no more. People don't even forget it, but God said, I won't hold it against you. When he says, I remember no more, he says, I won't count it against you. So saved person, you want to be forgiven? When you stand at that judgment seat of Christ, then it needs to be blotted out. Unsaved person, you can never begin to blot until you get saved. So everything that you have in the book of you will be witness against you when you stand in front of God on the final judgment day. That's how important the books are. When you go to Hebrews chapter 10, we're told about this old way of forgiveness. This old way of forgiveness still remembered sin, it says, but through the new covenant, which was Jesus' blood and our faith in his blood, the sins that we have committed are not just covered up, they're blotted out and taken out of the book of remembrance. Listen to verse 17 of Hebrews 10. And their sins and iniquities, again, I will remember when? No more. This is the second time we've been told this fact, so we really need to understand this. Our book, the book of you, the book of me, is a record of everything you've done. Things that please God, and also our sin that doesn't please him, that stands between us and God. If we use the blood of Jesus Christ through our repentance and confession and our faith, then we have our sins blotted out of our book. If we do not repent of those sins and use the blood of Jesus to blot out our sins, then the record of our sin is in our book. And that book will be the document that condemns you. The document that condemns you. To the unsaved person, if you never use the blood of Jesus to be born again, then your record of sin and rejection of that blood will condemn you to eternity in hell. That's as clear as I can put it. You say, well, why so coarse? It's not coarse. It's a warning. It's in the Bible. Revelation 20:15 says, and the books were opened, and the dead were judged according to those things which were written in the books. These books of me and you, they will condemn us. Condemn us. If there's never been any blotting. And if you have, or you do accept Jesus as your Savior and use the blood, then you will not be condemned to hell because your past sin has been blotted out. That's like we talk about being saved. And people say, well, what do you mean saved? Have you ever witnessed somebody and they don't understand saved? I remember when I got saved. And I was like 12 years old and I was on fire for God. I realized at that point I had a cognitive awareness that if I didn't accept the Lord Jesus Christ, I was going to die and go to hell. And then they preached about the rapture. And I was like, is this preacher ever going to get through so I can go up here and pray? I want to go up here and do this right. I thought that I was saved before, but I wasn't. I was just went through the motions, but I realized I was lost. I got saved and I went to school. And I remember the first guy that I witnessed to. When you get saved, you want to tell somebody, right? His name was Greg. I won't give you his last name, but I remember it all the way back to then. At least 20 years ago. No. I'm embellishing. I remember it back to then. I remember where I was at when I came up to witness to him and I said, listen, I got saved. Have you ever been saved? And he said, yeah, I've been saved. I was like, okay, well, that was my witness and opportunity by the God. I knew he wasn't. He was like, I got saved when I fell off my bike and my dad came up and picked me up and he saved my life. He said, what did you get saved from? I just got saved and I hadn't had that class. I really just did not know the answer, so I was stumped, right? I'm giving you the answer today. You're saved from being condemned to hell. You're saved from being condemned to hell. When he saves you, he blots out. When he saves you, he writes your name in another book. You see, we have our name in these three books if we choose to. But everybody has their name in two books. We're talking about books, and I talked to you about the book of you, but this other book that we have referenced in the Bible, we've referenced to it a couple of times, is the book of life, the book of the living. This book of life or the book of the living is just an account that you're alive. It's the record of every person that's ever been conceived, as we know that life begins at conception. We know that from the beginning of man, God's always recorded those who were given life. If you read the book of Genesis chapter 5, you'll see as God lists all the genealogy between Adam and Noah. And then after the flood, you'll read that he lists all the genealogy between Shem, Noah's son, and Abraham. And if you read after that in Matthew chapter 1, you'll see the list from Abraham to Jesus. So God keeps up with everything that he's given breath to. He knows it's in the book of the living. David said in Psalms 69:28. Let them be blotted out of the book of the living and not be written with the righteous. He was praying this to God, knowing that he wanted his enemies destroyed. So we need to know that every person has his name written or has a book that pertains to him. Two different books. That's the book of the living, if you're alive. Everybody in here alive? If you're alive, raise both hands. Amen. Nobody can say we have a dead church this morning, right? Raise them again. That's beautiful. You're in the book of the living. How about that? Tell the person beside of you, you're in the book of the living. You've already told them that you have a book of you and you gave your name. Now you're in the book of the living. But this third book is a book that not everyone is recorded in, but only those who repent of their sins and accept the blood of Jesus to take away their sins and become born again. You know what the name of this book is? It is called the Lamb's Book of Life. The Lamb's Book of Life. This is an important book. Everyone who believes in Jesus by accepting him and not rejecting him is recorded in Jesus' Book of Life. You said, I thought it was the Lamb's Book of Life. Same thing. Jesus' Book of Life, the Lamb's Book of Life, because Jesus is called the Lamb. In Isaiah 53 in the Old Testament, he was identified as the Lamb that was led to the slaughter. In John chapter 1, John saw him coming and John declared, behold the Lamb of God that's taken away the sin of the world. And if you read the book of Revelation chapter 5, you'll realize when we get to heaven, it's all going to be about the Lamb. We're going to gather around the Lamb because he's the only one that's worthy to cover our sins. And in the end of chapter 5, we'll be singing, worthy is the Lamb. Which is the same as victory in Jesus. Glory to God. The Lamb's Book of Life is the record of all those who get saved from eternal death and receive eternal life. But I don't want you to take my word for it. I want to give you a couple of things that the Lamb himself said, okay? In John chapter 6, he was speaking in verses 39 and 40. He said, and this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. That's judgment day. That's when the physical resurrection happens. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day. Guess what? That's the Lamb talking. Did you hear him? When your name is recorded in this book, the Lamb's Book of Life, then nothing can take it out. Nothing can take it out. He says, that which I record, nobody can take out. Now listen to John 10:10. The thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. That's the Lamb talking. You think he knows anything about eternal life? You think he knows anything about this life here? Absolutely. He came that we could have life and have it more abundantly. That's the Lamb talking. And then John chapter 10, verse 28. Here's something for you about eternal security. And I give unto them eternal life. They shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. When your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, no one can erase it. That's the Lamb talking. No one can take you out of his hand. The only way to get our name in this Lamb's Book of Life is to have our sins redeemed by the blood of that Lamb. Once his blood is used to redeem your sins, your name is written in that book. Peter puts it this way in 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19. He says, for as much as you know that you are not redeemed with corruptible things, that's money, silver and gold, or things that you inherited, right? With corruptible things such as silver and gold from your vain conversations received by tradition from your fathers. You can't even inherit enough money. You're not redeemed by money. He says, but with the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without blemish and without spot. The only way to be redeemed is by the Lamb. When he uses that blood to redeem you, then your name is recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life. So let's see how important this third book actually is, this Lamb's Book of Life. Three things I want to show you. It won't be long. We're all going to eat at the same time today. I want to show you something that happened during this era. You know, this is called the church age. The church age. That's everybody who is living from Jesus Christ until when Jesus comes back at the rapture. The church age. He writes a letter in Revelation chapter 3 to the church at Sardis. And he writes it to us too. This is going to be talking about the Lamb's Book of Life to the church age, to us, the bride of Christ. And then he tells us again later on about this Lamb's Book of Life. And we hear about it during the tribulation time. That's the 7 years that happen after the rapture. That's when the unsaved will be here. And there will be some people that are saved that get saved during that period. But that's during the tribulation time. And then he mentions the Lamb's Book of Life after everything is done here. And we're in heaven. So listen. Revelation 3:5, it says, as Jesus was speaking to the church of Sardis and to us, he says this, listen, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Listen to the Lamb talking. What does he say? He who overcomes. How do you overcome something? There's no way to overcome sin unless you use what? The blood of the what? The blood of the Lamb. But here's something interesting. He says that I will not blot his name out of the book of life. He that overcomes are going to be clothed in white raiment. That's a sign of our cleansing. We don't have blood-stained garments anymore. We have white robes. But when he says, I will not blot your name out, well, you know, some people would say, well, hey, you mean I can get my name blotted out of this book? Understand what he says here. He basically says, let me read it. I will not blot his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father. Jesus is not saying, he that overcomes, I will not blot his name, but I'll blot out the rest of them. He's saying, he that overcomes by the blood of the Lamb, I will not, I definitely will not, nobody can take his name out of my book. Amen? It's not that I will not blot it out if they're not bad. It's that I cannot blot it out. I will not blot it out. It's an assurance. There's no statement here that implies that someone can have their name blotted out of the Lamb's Book of Life, but rather the promise that they will not have their name blotted out of the Lamb's Book of Life. Isn't that a praise? Guys, every one of us here have probably done something worthy of having our name blotted out. So that should be somewhere where I would have to quiet you down right now because people are praising God. It's only by His grace that we don't get our names blotted out daily. Now let's read about those who do not accept the Lamb, Jesus. After the church is raptured, we read about the Antichrist. This is the anti-Lamb. This is the false Lamb. This is the man that will come on the scene that will deceive. He's the opposite of Christ, the Antichrist. And in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, listen to how the people that worship him are identified. You'll see how important this Lamb's Book of Life is. It says, Revelation 13, 8, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb. You know who his followers are going to be? Those whose names are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So we see the Lamb's Book of Life in this present age. We see the Lamb's Book of Life even identifying the saved and the lost in the tribulation time. And we also see the Lamb's Book of Life in our eternity, in our future. I want you to listen as Jesus describes the New Jerusalem, which is a description of heaven. For all those of us who accept Jesus and become His bride during this church age, in Revelation 21, next to the last chapter in the Bible, He talks about our future heaven. He calls it the New Jerusalem for the church. He describes the dimensions of it. This whole chapter is about the New Jerusalem. Have you ever heard that term? The New Jerusalem. And He tells about the dimensions, but I want you to see one specific thing that He says about the New Jerusalem, our future heaven. Verse 27, and there shall in no wise enter into anything that defileth, neither whatsoever maketh abomination or maketh a lie. Listen, who can go into it? But they which are written in the Lamb's Book of life. How about that? Hey, that's where you want to have your name. You don't want to guess about it. Jesus tells another story in Matthew 24 that he says, hey, on that day when they stand in front of me, even at the white throne judgment, there's going to be a lot of people, not just people, people that are being celebrated today as pastor appreciation, pastors, Sunday school teachers, church members, and they're going to stand and they're going to say, did we not proclaim in your name? Did we not do all these things? And he's going to say, I never knew you. What does he mean, I never knew you? He opens his book and says, you were not written down on my friend list. You never loved me. You never trust me. I never knew you. That is when it will be too late to get your name in the Lamb's Book of Life. Today, it is not too late. That's heavy, isn't it? And that book is a record all the way from this life through the tribulation into heaven. That's big, isn't it? Lamb's Book, that's a big book. Everybody's in two books. The book of the living, if you're alive. If you've been given life, there's a record of you. And the book of you, you've got one of those too, and I do too. It records everything. And I tell you what, you don't want to get the pages too full or you can't sincerely ask to be forgiven. Hard to even remember it, right? Only way to sincerely ask to be forgiven of all the sins is for something to happen that really just breaks you. Been there too. What you want to do is daily be able to go to God and ask Him to convict you strongly, to show you where you step out of His will, and ask Him for forgiveness from anything that you've done against Him. See, because when you blot out the sin, what's left are the things that He's going to reward you with, things that won't burn up. Things that aren't wood, hay, and stubble. Things that you'll be judged by, Christian. Things that matter to Him. It's a humbling thought to think. Let's take last week. What do you think God wrote in His book about you that brought glory to Him? And then what would He have written in your book that was selfishly done to please you? And then last month, and then last year. And it seems like if we don't have a picture of this book in our head, this book of you, I need a picture of that. I need to know that God's keeping an account, and the blood of Jesus, it'll forgive it, but I truly need to repent of it, and I need to remember that. We're all in these two books. Saved or lost. But this third book, this Lamb's Book of Life, it's so important that Revelation 20:15, that verse that's so eerie, it says, and whosoever was not found written in the Book of Life, that's the Lamb's Book of Life, was cast into the lake of fire. It's the ultimate thing for the person who refuses to get saved. As far as books go. Because he looks through the book, and that's an account of all your works, and he sees all these things. The books were opened, but then another book is open. Just because God has to be able to tell you that your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And if your name is not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, then you're cast into the eternal lake of fire. That's heavy. I would not want to not know. And Christian, your name is there. If it's in the Lamb's Book of Life, good. But understand that in that book of you, that book of you is so important because that book of you can be blotted out whenever you sincerely repent that you've done something against God and use that blood. But repentance is judged by God. It's not what we say, just I'm sorry. I've pulled in plenty of times to my house, and with having three boys, they've torn up everything that I've ever owned. Everything. And I've pulled in before, and I've said, don't throw the ball right there. If you throw the ball right there, you're going to break this something on the house, or something bad's going to happen. And I pulled in before, and after being told, they met me and said, listen, I broke this. That was a confession. But because that I pulled in the next time and they were doing it again, that was not repentance. They confessed what they did, but they weren't sorry. It was verbal confession. God looks at our words and then He looks at our heart and He says, did you mean it? You can be in this church service today and you can be convicted. And I pray for your conviction. I pray for my conviction. I pray for my children's conviction. And you can be convicted today and you can say, I'm sorry, but walk out of here and never meant it. There is nothing that gets erased out of your book. God speaks to you now in this service. Saved person and lost person, with the ability to blot out your sins and remember them no more. Based on the promise, if you confess your sins, He is faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Listen, we need to check our books today, don't we? The Lamb's Book of Life, I hope you understand it. But understand, you can't be in the Lamb's Book of Life until you erase the book of you from Jesus back. We get it, don't we? How do you fix these things that make you feel nervous now? You pray. We're going to have an invitation. You're going to have an opportunity to come to God. Ask Him to show you your book. That book's going to have everything that you're accountable for. Mothers, it's going to have your accountability as a mother to those children. Fathers, it's going to have your accountability as a father to those children. Understand, God didn't give them to you for you to just have, to make football, baseball players and little ballerinas and dancers out of. That's good if it happens. He gave them to you to bring them to Jesus Christ. And to have fellowship with God. If you fail at that, you're failing. Husbands and wives, He didn't give you that husband or wife to be able to support them and give them the things of life. He gave you that person to be your helpmate, to be one in God. Not to get things together, but to get closer to God together. And then let God put His favor on you. Young people, He's not giving you all the things that you think are so important right now, the success and the friends and this and that. He's giving you opportunity to be around those people to change lives. And then He'll put favor on you. He's giving you a body that's young and pure and ask you to keep it for Him. He's giving that to you. That's precious. He loves you. He wants every person, whosoever will, let him come. He wants every person to be in this Lamb's Book of Life. But after you get in this Lamb's Book of Life, He keeps writing. White throne judgment, judgment seat of Christ. It's all according to the books. God's keeping up with it. Let's pray. Lord, I love you, I praise you, and I thank you for this day. I thank you for reminding us, Lord, that you care about us enough to keep up with us. I pray, God, that you minister to us during this invitation, Lord. I pray if there's any person here that's never trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior, they've never received the blood of the Lamb, they've never repented of their sins, or they're just not sure, I pray, God, you give them a courage, a boldness right now, Lord, to be able to come and pray and have their sins blotted out. And then, Lord, I pray for Christians today I pray, God, that you convict us. Show us where we're at right now. Show us our book. During this invitation, open a portion of our book to our minds and let us see these are not things you're pleased with, or let us see that these are the things you are pleased with. Show us ourselves, I pray. God, let prayers be offered all over this room today where lives are changed and people rededicate to you. I just pray you move in this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Page Amen. Thank you so much for being here today. Festivities have just begun. We're going to get to fellowship and worship with one another. I praise God for his time of praise and service he's given us. I pray that that book is continually in your mind as it is in my mind, that we give an account of every day, look in our book and see what it is that we need to get blotted out. And I pray that it becomes a picture that you can take from this place and it helps you to be closer to the Lord. Now, as we go out here and prepare to eat together, I know we ran a little bit over today, but we started late. We had all that pastor appreciation stuff we had to do. And so it happened to get the sermon started late, and I couldn't cut it off or won't cut it off, and it's just what the Lord had to say today. But the bright side is you can be at lunch at record time today. All you have to do is walk from here back to there, okay? And there is every selection that you would want to have, better than any buffet you would want to go somewhere. So thank you to everybody that cooked, everybody that prepared, everybody that just comes together. And like David said, if you didn't bring anything or maybe you forgot, nobody knows it. We want you to come out there. So we appreciate you being here. We want you to eat with us. And then after we eat, we want to come back in here and sing to the Lord and give praise to him and just have a good time of fellowship. So we're going to go out there. You can go out this door right here. And if you need to go to your car, you can. But we're going to say the blessing in here and thank the Lord for the food. And then I guess they'll tell you out there how to get in line. Remember, if there are anyone here that is aged or cannot walk or cannot stand, they need to be in the front of the line. Be respectful of those people who have any kind of physical infirmity. Anybody who's a senior citizen, make sure that they're not standing in line for a long time. So be respectful of that, okay? And then we'll just eat together. So any announcement before we do that? Did I forget to say something? Good. I'm going to have the blessing. And then we can just assemble and they'll tell us when we can eat out there. So make sure when you're out there, talk to somebody that you don't know. Like talk to somebody that you do know, but introduce yourself to somebody so that everybody can know one another. Father, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you for the good day you've given us. We thank you for having your spirit and your presence in this place. I just pray, God, as we go out here and eat together, that you would bless the food for nourishment of our body. Lord, I just pray that you would let us use our bodies for your service. And I pray, God, for the hands of each person that prepared and those that take part in eating, and grow us closer, unify us, Lord, as a church body, I pray. Be with our day today, Lord, as we come back in praise to you. I pray that your spirit moves in the song service. Lord, thank you for being with us. Thank you for considering us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for putting us in that book. In Jesus' name.